response to psychological is get on with it. Because you know, you're going to have to get on with it, you're going to have to get uncomfortable. But just briefly, and I don't particularly love it when speakers go, oh my God, I was in a terrible situation and property saved me. However, I'm extremely grateful for what property has done. My two are now 22 and 19. She's working in my business for a year and she's storming it actually. She's doing really well. Obviously we had a few bumps early on, but that's fine. She's doing great. And he actually lives in a property that I own. It's the only one that is not within 17 minutes of my house and my office in Bristol. It's up in Glasgow, but it's within 15 minutes of his grandparents, my mum and dad. And so he goes to his mum and my mum and dad once a week for tea, the same tea every week, spaghetti bolognese, and the same cake, lemon cake, every single week. And then my mum makes twice the amount of food and sends him home with it. So it feels really good. And I have been head of household since he was 2 and he's 19. And that, at times, is quite an uncomfortable place to be. It's lovely because you get twice the amount of hugs, but you also have twice the amount of responsibility. And I'm very, very family focused. I'm very aware that, you know, with one person, there's not a safety net to break the fall. You know, it's just one, although I'm close to my parents, obviously. And so I was very conscious of that and slightly uncomfortable around that, because if anything happened to them, or to me, what would happen to them? So it was a very useful piece of being uncomfortable. And I used that uncomfortableness to drive myself forward. So really, you know, whatever your situation is, and I don't want to, you know, talk too much about being uncomfortable, but we certainly were financially quite tight. Try and think about what is going to drive you forward, because to make the change, I mean, now I'm kind of, you know, to get up to the mountain before you start skiing downhill is really hard work. And so you're only going to do it if you're really, really driven, and at some times there's something that's forcing you out into that discomfort of taking some risks and, you know, smashing it until you're shattered, working 16-hour days and all the rest of it at the beginning. You know, now it's lovely, you know, it's a ski downhill, but that took maybe 5 years really from being a landlord. So maybe about 2 years ago that started to chill out. So try and think about what you can use, if you like, for your own psychology. For me, it was, I have to have my kids safe. And it's really lovely that they both are, and I've got houses identified for both of them. They ain't getting them, because actually I need them both to have some grit. You know, like, how do you make a pearl? You got to put some grit in a, you know, in an oyster. And so I very much need my two to have grit and to be hard workers. And they are turning out okay. Although, yes. He can be a monkey, but, you know, he's settling down, which is really nice. So for me, it was never about supersonic amounts of cash. I was never really hugely bothered about that. It was very much about security. And I actually achieved my kind of early goal ages ago. And now, it's delightful. I just genuinely don't need to work. We were saying, the only bit of work I actually need to do is about the 2 hours a week I do with my head of lettings. So I have a portfolio that's managed internally. There's, at the moment, there's 5 of them, but we'll cull it back down to 3 and we'll move 2 people elsewhere in the business. So 3 people manage my portfolio and I only work a 2 hour a week to discuss it with head of lettings. Now the rest of the stuff, crazy lady, I do for fun. But that didn't take long to really theoretically move your ability to pay all your bills down to 2 hours a week, because actually I outsource. But they're assets that are outsourced, not rent to rent. So just think about what is going to drive you forward and just appreciate with property. It won't take that long as you kind of rocket fuel it at the very start. Oh, sorry. I'm getting there. I'm getting used to this. Is that right? There we go. So I started like many other people, 60 grand up my own mortgage. You know, nothing fancy, nothing special, you know. And I had no intention of raising any money. And to be honest, I had no intention of coming to property meets like this. And I didn't even know they existed. And I was just going to buy some houses because the 6 month rule didn't exist. And literally, the year I started, which was just after the recession crash, so everybody thought I was completely mental. I mean, all my friends at my CrossFit gym were like, "Are you sure?" "Yeah, I'm fine." They're like, "Really?" You know, I mean, if your friend starts in a recession buying property when it's crashing and it's doom and gloom, you are going to try and tell them it's not a very good idea. And they put in a 6 month rule. For those that don't know, 6 month rule is for some of the more retail buy-to-let mortgage providers like Birmingham Midshires, you buy it and you can't refinance it for 6 months. So for example, my second property, I bought for 85,000, spent 7 grand doing it up and knew it was worth 130. but couldn't refinance it to 130 value to pull out all of my money, by the way, for 6 months. Well, that really pissed me off, because I wasn't going to go very far or very fast on a 60 grand deposit if I couldn't refinance immediately. That'd be like 1,500 a year. I wasn't going to do that because I wasn't going to get anywhere fast then. So I then raised money. And so it was only circumstances, really. But that's how I started. So I, in a room like this, Bristol Pin, my local pin, went every single month, collected business cards religiously from every single person. Oh, have you collected these in? You've got some. Do you want to pass them over to Patricia?
Thank you.
Oh, man, we didn't get you. collected business cards, and then I did, after every single meet, I would phone like 10 people and do two copies. So collect at least 10 business cards and have two copies. And I raised £600,000 in just over 3 months, which allowed me to buy my first portfolio at £1.8 million. At that point, I thought buying £1 million worth of property was quite a lot. You know, now I'm like, oh, that's really cute. But and then I just was able to jump out of my day job, which took 18 months. So if you're looking to give you an idea of time frame, it doesn't take long at all. We know this guy. Does everybody know Vanish?
Yeah.
Yes. So he's a real patron, isn't he, of this meet?
Yeah. Friend of the show. Friend of the show.
Friend of the show, yes, yes. So has he kicked your asses on a regular basis?
Yeah, was he last month?
Was he?
Yeah.
Have you not met him?
No.
Absolutely worth going to see. I think brain the size of a country is probably about right. He will not sugarcoat it. So I used to go to his meet a bit like you guys. I'd be in Bristol, but I just thought Vanish was so smart. On a Monday, I would take the train after the full day's work. My kids were old enough that I'd sorted out tea and they were like watching telly and going, all right, Mum, see you when you get back. And I would take the train up to London, shattered, Twix, sandwich, Coca-Cola, go to his meet in London and then run to get the last tube back, to get the last train back to Bristol, cause just because his brain was so good. And I remember going in there and going, right, I'm going to do 60 deals. That's right, 60 deals we're going to do in a year. And I think he just went, oh my lord, I better look after her because she's going to go there. And what did we do last year? 63 deals. The first year we did 43. Like the first year jumping out my job, we did 43 deals. So we didn't quite hit the 60, but we weren't a million miles away. And he's been kind of telling me what to do ever since, often starting off with what you're doing wrong is.
Really?
But absolutely superb. So I would highly recommend. And I was very cynical about the people selling education, I have to tell you. And he actually phoned me up for 9 months until eventually I went, oh right, it would probably be sensible to work with you officially. Because I realised that every single time I had a conversation I got amazing value. So highly recommend. I know he's doing JV, like a JV mentoring group at the moment. Highly recommend Vanish, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the other one's a wee bit surprising. You obviously all know this guy, don't you? Mm-hmm. Very conscious and very aware of him. Well, he is a British weightlifting champion. He competed at the Commonwealth Games. He is now going for the Olympics and hopefully will represent Britain in the Olympics. He's 21 now, and I train with him 3 times a week because I'm fortunate to really be into weightlifting, you know. And I'm a British champion for people over a certain age. There are not many of us, so it's a little bit easier. But the thing that really inspires me about Sonny, I mean, I do kind of talk to him about his university career and nag him to buy houses because he keeps buying Gucci belts, and you know, he drives a convertible BMW at age 21. But and I'm like, buy a house, be skint, buy a house. He's like, Suze, it doesn't sound very hot. The thing that's really useful to take from that is, you know, there's often a lot of parallels between sport and business, isn't there? And of course, I'm in a really lucky position. I'm actually being trained by an international athlete. You know, he was out in America competing recently, and he's, we'd hope, going to score very highly in the Europeans in about 10 weeks' time. So I see things that you don't see on stage, if you like. So I'm going, oh yeah, we've done 44 million quid's worth of property that we bought for 30 million quid. But you don't see all the graft behind the scenes. You don't see all the days where it's just really hard. Hello, coming in. You don't see the attitude that says, I'm going to put a stupid heavy bar above my head and I'm going to think this is going to work. So do you remember when I went back and said about Vanish, I'm going to do 60 deals? Really? You know, that was invincible attitude I had. And that actually makes a difference. So it's all about attitude, belief that you can do it. Daily graft, making it happen. him, and just be so sure that this can be done. Because frankly, if other people can do it, and I'm telling you I've done it, then of course you can do it. There's absolutely no reason why you can't. He bombed out in a competition, which was a competition to qualify, a seriously high-level competition to qualify, for the Europeans. He completely bombed out. If you know anything about lifting, you do 3 lifts. And if you don't make one of the lifts, you're done. And he bombed out. And I was thinking, oh my God, this is going to be like hairy on Monday morning. I went, are you all right, son? He went, yeah, bombed out. It's going to be great next time. That was it. Attitude. You know, it's really, and that is how you get to that level, as well as train. It's absolutely belief that, yeah, no big deal, negative, off, move forward. It just doesn't get caught on a hook. So try and take some of those lessons that I'm certainly taking from a 21-year-old lad into the business, because it is a business you're working on. Oh, and I'm so sorry, we sent this to you a little bit early. We're now 200 deals. We were 5 years old on the 21st of January, and he pulled out deal number 97, 98, 99, and deal 200 on that day, because I kept going, are you going to make it? Are you going to make it? Are you going to make it? So he pulled out a block of flats. Okay, fair play. And it's now it's 44 million quid's worth of property at 30, just under 30 million quid that we did in 5 years. And that, and we're very, very conservative about what things are valued up at. On purpose. I think out of the first 200 deals, we've only been, if you like, wrong, probably 4 or 5 times, and by 2.5 to 5 grand, 1 by 10 grand. In a recession, when people are downvaluing the market, that is extremely good. So, who's seen our YouTube videos? You have. What do you reckon? You can say it. I don't mind. You can tell me what you think.
They're probably some of the most insightful that are. They're not selling. They are based around what you actually do.
So I sometimes look incredibly hot, having just trained with no makeup in a tracksuit. Hot stuff. Going, I really should have done my hair. But what, they're real, aren't
they're
they?
Real,
yeah, real. I'm just joking about myself. Yeah, and it's all about property. Yeah. So do you use the playlists? Because we put them into different playlists like Buy to Sell, Raising Finance,
I probably haven't, but I binge watch.
Yeah. Like that. Oh, good. We get like 12,000 views a month now, which is quite cool. So there's no bullshit, it's straightforward property. Do you watch them as well?
Yes, I've seen quite a few of those.
And what do you think?
Really enjoy them actually, yeah, pretty
cool.
Good.
What do you get? Fun. So you're getting insight and reality,
yep.
Apart from sorry about the lack of makeup.
it's a good reminder actually to a lot of the stuff that you know you should be doing and you forget about it, but
yes.
It's actually sort of a reminder that actually you should go back and actually look at that again.
Yes.
Really insightful.
Good, so quite useful again.
Yeah.
That's what they're there for. They're there absolutely to just pass on good information. And it's all stuff that we've learnt and we just want it as peer-to-peer. So it's Susanna Cole, The Good Property Company. If you just look up on YouTube, have a wee look for that. And then we put out a lot of stuff on our Facebook pages and LinkedIn profiles and Twitter. And I've just learnt how to do Instagram now because my daughter's 22 and she's helping in the marketing team. So I wasn't allowed to tweet for a while because I was so embarrassing. Fern, but now I'm allowed to tweet. But we put out loads, hopefully loads of really good quality information. And do you know how it works in our favour? Because we've been doing YouTube videos for like 2.5 years. It means that people decide whether they want to work with us. They can do their evaluation. And so basically anybody that's here tonight thinking you're going to be a millionaire overnight, I am definitely not the right person for you because I am going to just pop that bubble immediately. And I'll go, right, so you're going to have no money, be knackered and sleepless for a few years. Are you cool? Now you can be a millionaire, you know. So it means that crowd bounces off and decides that we're not selling the dream, we're selling reality. Or we're telling reality. So it means that the people that do come forward are almost self-selected, which is really wonderful, which is a nice sideline, if you like, for us. And then, there we go. So we're going to talk. So the quick intro, which is have an attitude, believe you can do it, work hard as stink, take as much information elsewhere, collect everybody's business cards from today and phone them all up and meet them all up for coffee. Kind of neat, I should stop there, to be honest, and you'll get enough value out of if you follow through on every single one of those. So when I started, I would collect people's business cards and I put them in an Excel spreadsheet And then I would follow them up with a phone call, and I'd go to voicemail 4, and I thought, well, if somebody doesn't want to speak to me, they'll probably ignore me 4 times. But the reality is, because we've done a time and motion study, obviously, because we're total geeks, that we are, which is why I'm not keen on rent-to-rent, because we know it's a £17 an hour job, and I want you to have an asset,
yeah.
not a liability, which is a bloody light bulb you're going to argue about with a tenant. You know, we know that in this room, on average, 1 in 5 of you will answer your phone because you're probably working or you're busy. So you will need to phone people 3 or 4 times, and you're not intruding on them. And hopefully you've got, so even if you're beginning, you've got something that could be of use to them. You know, it may not be a property specific thing, but you might know something else. So always go into those relationships trying to figure out what you can do to be very useful to the other person in a, you know, properly genuine way. And it just works out beautiful. Let's talk content, shall we? Now we've talked psychology, get uncomfortable, believe you can do it, and graph like stick. Yeah. Raise money, source deals, and buy to sell. Okay, we're going to use some practical examples because I like practical examples best. Mug Street. Mug Street is the one that's earmarked for my daughter. So it's like people of a certain generation, rhubarb and custard. I just think of Mug Street like rhubarb and custard. It's like really comforting little cartoon of a house. Obviously, because it's one of my houses, it's painted pale blue at the front, because in Bristol they do a lot of pale blue houses. So I try and paint every house I own pale blue. And Ash tries to like make me not, but I mainly get away with it. So, Mug Street now, just to give you an idea, will sell for 330. When did I buy it? 3.5 years ago. Isn't that cool? Buy assets. Because 3.5 years ago, it was valued up at 250. It is now valued at 330. 80 grand, I'm just trying to persuade you not necessarily to move into rent to rent. 80 grand in 3.5 years, that's 20 grand a year just under, isn't it? That's just one house and I own lots.
Actually, one of my neighbours made more than that in 2 flats. And
so you know.
And he's like nearly 100 now, bless him. So,
so
he's still flipping properties.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
So you know that assets are the thing to keep.
Yeah.
So bought for 145, it was a fairly hefty refurb, cost at 38, revalued at 250. And that's a Rick's valuation because I refinanced it because I'm keeping it because my little Baba, who's now 22, is probably going to go into from an estate agent. Who's sourcing from estate agents? Okay, how successful are you? How many phone calls? How successful is it being so far? Give us.
We've got a couple.
Okay.
Was like market price, it's small town. We just got one.
Discounted? Or at market price?
At market price, the first two.
Okay.
The third one cost me a Christmas present, so I went in there with a box of chocolates and they reminded them.
So relationship.
Mindset and the game of the deal.
How discounted was the third one?
About 25k below your price.
So discount, discount equals relationship.
Yeah.
Yep, that's what we find. And you went in, you were proactive.
Yeah.
Yep, that's what we find. And how many phone calls are you making a week?
Well, we're going through the sale of this one, the third one. Probably 2 or 3. No,
okay.
We could do more.
Yes, you could. Yes, you could. Seriously, do more. If you wanted to buy more. And how much money are you going to make off this one?
Well, they've got sitting tenants at the minute,
okay.
So we need to wait until June before we can have a look at it, but it's likely to be on HMI.
Okay. Okay, great. So you're going to make good income.
Mm-hmm.
And you're doing deal sourcing as well with estate agents?
I've only used one, really, but he tends to ring me up whenever he's got a property, then just generally I'll probably get about 10% off market value.
So 0, 0, 25%, 10%.
Yeah.
But you notice the numbers are small, and he's ringing you, not you ringing him. And
yeah.
It's no criticism, it's just to look at what a picture is.
Yeah, well it suits me because I've sort of got most of my capital tied up at the moment in HMO, just stuff like that. He offered me two flats the other day.
Yeah.
80,000, and yet other agents are selling the same block at 95,000. And I could have had them, but I just didn't want to because I'm just tied up a lot of money.
So if you got them at a cheaper discount, you'd have more money to buy more.
Yeah.
So it might be an idea just to widen out the sourcing from one.
Mm.
Any more comments? So 10% is decent, but let's get it lower than that. And at market value, because you run out of money. Any more comments on sourcing from estate agents?
I just like to add, being an ex-estate agent, there are some tips on becoming like a favoured buyer.
Do you want to tell everybody?
Okay, so when I was an estate agent, I used to sell to some very sort of active buyers. And I knew when a property came on, like for example, if someone was going for a divorce and they wanted to sell it very quickly, I could solve their problems for them. And I wasn't a typical run-of-the-mill estate agent. I didn't bullshit anyone. I would take you to a house, and if I didn't think it was right, I'd say, don't buy it, it's a shithole, basically.
Yes.
I think that basically, if they say they, you know, they've got something for you, then go out and view it, whether you're going to make an offer or not. Make a cheeky offer, because you don't know until something's on the table what you can get tied up. Because until you actually ask someone what they actually want, you don't actually know.
And how fast between you speaking to the person and them coming out to view? For Ash, it's he'll speak to them and he'll be out within 3 hours to 24 hours latest.
Yeah, mostly the ones that I could get them in that day.
Yes.
And I would get the deal in the book that day.
That's what we do. We get the call and we buy it that day.
And then they would give me a nice cup of tea out of it as well. And
yes.
I wouldn't ask for that. They just would, because I offered them a good service. So
yes.
Tip, it really helps, like pay it forward. I know that's something that we get taught quite a lot about, but I used to get tipped, and it did motivate me. I'm not going to lie, I was based on commission. I was a salesperson, so still am. Money speaks, and you know. So that's
interesting, because we've actually never tipped an estate agent ever, but we do a lot of Christmas presents. But we've
same thing. Like gesture, just a nice gesture, isn't it?
Yes, it's the gesture.
Mm.
So do you notice how fast we're talking about? So if you're sat there, and this is the problem with people who are still working full time, is how on earth are you going to get that opportunity? Because you phone at 10:30, you need to be out there by 12, and you have it tied up by 2, end of. Or the equivalent to Ash, who's my sourcer, will be in your area and he'll have tied it up. So one of the things you guys can do if you're still working is take Thursday, Friday off on holiday. Don't have holidays for your first year. This is another reason why our YouTube videos work, because I tell the truth. Don't have any holidays except for to do property, and smash out the phone calls. Do 40 phone calls in a day for Thursday, Friday, and as soon as you've got a deal, go out, see it, get it booked in. And then you might want to view on Saturday as well. I used to take Thursday, Friday off, 40 phone calls on the Thursday, 40 phone calls on the Friday, and then at worst I'd be viewing between 10 and 13 properties on the Saturday, and I'd send all my offers on Saturday night. And we'll talk later on about offering professionally. So speed is really important. Proactivity, we are calling about 100 to 130 estate agents a week, because I have never ever looked on Rightmove ever to buy a property, ever. Just, it's a complete waste of time, because by the time it's on Rightmove as a retail property, we're buying wholesale. So it's the sweet spot between it coming in and it getting listed. And that's when you want to be grabbing it, which is why, again, if you're working, maybe you want to systematise your diary and say, I'll hit Thursday, Fridays. So this one, yep, quite nice. Did I spend any of my own money on it? No, of course not. Why would I do that? I mean, also, and please don't feel worried about this, I have never agreed to buy a property when I've had the money, ever. Never, because I would not have gone this fast if I had done that. I would not own as many properties as I currently own if I'd actually waited until I had the cash. And today, I bought myself a birthday present. So it's the first new build I've ever bought. It's like, oh my God. And it's a ridiculous, it's complete inverse of what I'm teaching you now. But the reason I'm buying it is it's on the water, it's opposite a historic site, it is literally the centre of Bristol, and it's a stupid price, right? But it's just gonna be to die for the rest of Bristol's life. And I'm buying myself a fancy two-bed new build for my birthday. Not to live in, just because I want it. I've wanted it for 5 years, and they've been doing this renovation. Of course, they got stymied in the recession. So I just looked at this derelict building that they're building for 5 years. So don't do that until you can have fun, you know. But basically, no. Yes, and I reserved it today. But do I have the money to spend 600 grand on a two-bed flat? No, of course not. Why would I wait till I had the money in the bank? God, no. No, I need to put 50 grand down in a month's time and then need to buy in October. I'm going to chill out and it'll be fine. I'll get the money by then. So, and I just got no worries about that at all, because again, your network. So how did I raise the money? I borrowed 100% of a loan from one investor. Where did I meet that person? In a room just like this in Bristol. And how did I meet him? Well, I stood up, you know how people get you to do the service provider, you know my name is. And I had a really quite nice brochure. So I stood up, in fact, I've got my packs actually to show you. So I had quite a nicely designed brochure. So I didn't have one of those yellow t-shirts saying, give me JV Finance, because I don't know if that's quite quality, but you know, good luck if you're doing that. But you know, my name is Susanna Cole. I make money with my funds and other people's funds. A good example, bought for 85,000, worth 130, renovation 7. If you want to do stuff like that with me, come and speak to me. No. Totally nervous. I mean, this was not cool. I was not relaxed. And he just went, call me. And that was it. And I was so stupidly busy at the time. You know, if anybody's at the kind of beginning point of your property business, oh my God, is it not wood for trees? You're so stupidly busy because you're not yet efficient at everything. You don't know what to do.
Most systems.
systems. And so you're creating a business, running a business, and kind of only starting to be good at it. So, you know, thankfully, I liked him. He had a brilliant business brain, and we went for like 8 or 9 meetings. And now he puts 600 grand my way every single year and has done for the last 5 years. Meeting him next week, and he's like, okay, you know, hurry up and spend my money. Ah, okay. I don't really, and he actually, last time I met him, he's like, you don't need me anymore. And I was like, no, I don't actually. But actually, I really like working with him. His brain is really good. So I'm totally, you know, I'm white, Scottish freckles, and he's Asian, but we have and a different religion to me, and a different sex to me, and a different language to me, but we have the same family values. We spend about 10 minutes talking about the deal, and then we spend an hour and a half talking about our kids and all the worries about our kids, and he's going, oh, you need to pay Zach some more pocket money. I'm like, oh no, I'm going to keep him lean. He's like, no, he's got to have, you know, so he got Zach a pocket money raise, you know.
You don't need him anymore, you can always pass him my way.
Pass him your way.
Yeah, be happy to look after him.
Because two things, we'd same kind of very different cultural values, of course, because we come from very different cultures and very different backgrounds, but we'd same family values, so we really got each other, and then his business brain. So one of the things you're going to find in raising private finance is the kind of guys that are going to be your big guys, your big investors, are usually people who have bought and sold businesses or developed businesses and then sold them. And what happens, one, like right now, you know, I was kind of full on energy to you because I couldn't work for 5 hours and I was going mental in the car because because of the flood. I actually had to stay on a train for an hour and a half and then get off the train and then go in my car. Well, I come to talks on a train because I'm working. You know, there's no way I'm not going to have 5 hours not working. No way, not at the moment in my business. So I don't mean this in any way, but I am in massive demand right now, both for my team and obviously, you know, all external stuff, but particularly we've got so much going on. And what happens when you sell that business? So one minute you're vital, and the next minute you have limited meaning. And actually, if you love business like I do, you're loving the whole thing, right? So what I was giving him, as well as an opportunity to earn some money, was an opportunity to be vital again, an opportunity to use his brain, which was like massive, on my little hinky-dink business, you know, 5 years ago. So he would give me loads of business advice. You know, from a guy who'd sold a multi-million pound business. And I'm like, okay, that's amazing. I didn't know about that. So working with private investors is not just about the money. If you get the really top guys or top ladies, it's the brain across it. And of course, you're like a fun project. Because what else are they going to do? They've made it. Well, what does making it mean? You're no longer doing what you love sometimes. You don't have the hassle, but you're not loving it either. So 100% loan for the personal guarantee to buy the house, thank you very much. So effectively a private mortgage. And then do you think I put my own money in for the refurb?
No.
Because like I only had 60 grand to start with. So I borrowed that and put a restriction on another property, and the restriction is called an RX1. You can lift it with an RX4. It basically means that you can't refinance or sell that property. So whilst they can't force you to give the money back, nonetheless, there's an adequate, depending on your agreement and their agreement, an adequate piece of safety for them. So I borrowed the 38,000. There you go. So they got some interest. Great.
So, sorry.
But I got that. Please do. No, talk. This is good.
The RX4, RX1. So is that between you and the investor?
Yes. So get your lawyer to do it.
Okay.
Yeah. So get your. You need two lawyers. You need a commercial lawyer to do the legal agreements. And actually, to be fair, my conveyancing lawyer did the legal agreements here, like a private mortgage and any joint venture agreements. And then your conveyancing lawyer, which is your property lawyer, will do the RX1. As it was, Milo was actually quite experienced, so he did both.
So does that give the investor security on their side that you're not going to run away with their investment?
No, what it gives them is a level of security. So let's say this is the house that the RX1 is. It kind of caps it. I can't sell it or refinance it and get money out, like say you had the RX1 without your permission.
Okay.
I can sulk for the rest of your life, but what good is that going to do me? So it's not a perfect security, so you've got to check out the ups and downs and always take legal advice and always give write to your investors in writing, if you see what I mean, and tell them to take legal advice as well. But it's an adequate security for a smaller amount of money, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, the first legal charge obviously gives the lender total security, but with the RX1 is kind of a restriction.
Yes.
The strict restriction, actually what it does is it creates the legal precedent for the lender to sue you. So it's not just the level of security that it stops you from doing something with that asset without their knowledge. It actually means if they needed to
they could.
You turn around and sulk, so you're not going to have it back.
Yes.
It's the precedent to take to court.
Yes. And other things I've used in the past are second charges or equitable charges, which is otherwise known as floating charges. Now, I take legal advice on this. I can't give you legal advice. But, you know, there's all sorts of ways of being able to secure people's monies, and it's only fair that their money should be secured. And obviously, legal agreements.
Hi, sorry. Just a quick question on the RX1.
See what I mean?
RX4.
He knows more than me.
Can you not just get it off the land registry and do it yourself, or do you need to take...
I would never do any legal work without my lawyer doing it. I'm not qualified, I want my lawyer to do that.
Okay.
So build a team, that's your number one thing. Make sure you've got amazing lawyers, and we run three sets of lawyers.
One more question, who pays for your lawyers?
I do.
In the initial...
I do,
yeah.
I'm very happy to do that, actually.
Yeah.
Yes.
The other thing is, would your investor put a great deal of faith in you if you downloaded a form from the internet, gave them, told them to sign it, and promised to send it to land registry?
Oh no, I was thinking for me to sign it and then give it to them, and then they can actually post it themselves.
I act as investor,
yes.
And I act
as an investor.
The business owner.
Yes.
In different circumstances. I wouldn't be happy if someone said, I'm going to deal with this myself.
No.
Said, do you know what?
No.
I'll put it through my solicitor and you can pay it.
Yes,
or
exactly.
Put it through your solicitor and you can pay it.
And often I'll pay my investors legal costs. I mean, that's
so
fair.
Yeah,
that's, do you know what? In the grand scheme of life, you know, one more month on beans on toast. So without being too naughty, you guys know that we've got packs, or please do.
What is the difference between this private investors?
Yes.
And his independent advisors?
Oh, totally different. So he gives me money, the other guy gives me advice and directs me to formal funding, like banks and commercial companies.
Are they reliable though?
Oh yeah. So this is a good question around team. So you've got two different kinds of funding teams that you need to build. Well, you need to build a building team, you need a legal team, you need an admin team, a sourcing team, and a financing team. And your financing team, in my view, unless you're sitting there with buckets of money, and you know, if you are, hands up and everybody will dive on you, is going to be private fundraising and formal fundraising. So my number one thing I do, like an absolute massive geek, is to check my credit file every single month. Not because I'm missing anything, because I've never missed anything in my bloody life, but in case there's a mistake on it, I cannot afford not to be top of the range getting formal funding. So that is where my financial advisor comes in. Now, personally, we have two. We have one for what you might call normal buy-to-let mortgages, and then we have one for commercial funding, including bridging and short-term lending, which is the buy-to-sell lending.
Yeah.
So, but there you have to put in 30 to 25% money, and it's all formal, and you know, my bank accounts are immaculate, so I just go, yeah, no problem, here's your information. So that is formal funding, and it's important that you have a formal fundraising strategy and say, who am I going to, you know, hang out with, who don't, you know, like Handelsbanken, for those that are longer in the tooth, you know, who am I going to develop relationships with? And then informal funds, so that's a financial advisor. Now, you do not take one off the internet, because you absolutely need one that's really, really good.
Because we do HMOs, and
yes.
The HMOs is very limited
all
the financing you can get direct from the bank.
Shawbrook, Aldermore, Paragon, are you doing those guys?
No, we're doing those right now because they agreed to do that bank.
Uh-huh.
So Lloyds are doing good thing for us, but independent advisors. houses have got mortgages with less interest rates.
Yes.
Less deposit.
Yes.
But I was finding it difficult to trust them.
Oh, well, you just need to take a good recommendation.
Yeah.
It's about understanding. Your financial advisor is not a computer says no person. Your financial advisor needs to be able to pick up and to talk to the operation director, to talk to the sales director, to talk to the chief underwriter, to be able to talk through your case in advance. And if your financial advisor can't do that, on to the next one. Find the one that can. There's no computer says no kind of nonsense. Otherwise, you won't get the kind of funding you need. And then the other one, your other team is your informal funders, which is these guys. And that is however you decide to structure it. So Tarek lends me 100%, fine, he gets security. And so I can scale. That's infinitely scalable, isn't it? As long as I can bring the deals in. And we've proven we
how
can.
How do you build trust with your private investor?
Aha! I think you must be a plant in my audience. Thank you. Do you know what's kind of I find really interesting? Because we've got a bit of a profile now, because we do a lot of social media and you know all that stuff. So I was thinking that we have a profile, we're known to be honest, we're known to be trustworthy, we're known to be steady and stable and, you know, just proper, you know. I was thinking that would shortcut things. No, it really doesn't. It's really interesting. So it's got nothing to do with me, it's got everything to do with human nature. 6 to 9 touch points, and I don't include email. I don't think email is a personal touch point, meaning arranged phone calls. Not like, oh, hi, it's just lovely to meet you, I've bumped into you. No, lovely to meet you, I've bumped into you. Let's talk about fundraising. Okay, now let's have a coffee or a phone call where we know that the agenda is to talk about that. So you're primed, I'm primed, we know what we're going to talk about. So 6 to 9 touch points on average 6 months, but people will pop at 3 months and people, one guy said, I was waiting until you were successful before I invested, you know, smart cookie, obviously. And we will send you the slides, and you take as many photos as you like, but we'll also send you the slides, as long as we've got your details. Cool. And on average, people will give you 50 grand. So we've got a little three grander, which turned into 30 grand the following year. And then we've got people like Tarek who now say, look, I want you to take 600 grand every year. And actually, if you don't take it, that impedes my own investing strategy. So that's really frustrating for me if you don't deliver on that, please. That's the, you know, but it doesn't, well, if you think about it from their point of view, they need to invest the money. They need somebody reliable to invest the money. So can you please hurry up and take the money? You know, the conversation next week is going to be, Susanna, can you please hurry up and take the money? Oh, okay. So, and it doesn't change whether you have a level of kind of reputation and therefore have something to lose if you're going to screw up, or if you are sitting in the seats 3 months into your property journey. There is no difference. It's 6 to 9 touch points on average 6 months. Every single relationship, because I track Pat, is very, very similar. So it's just build trust. It's like dating, isn't it, to be quite honest. So you just take your time, figure them out. So I ran a fundraising campaign, which consisted of, hello, my name is Susanna. I'm totally mortified standing up, but I really am uncomfortable and really want to build a multi-million-pound portfolio, so I better stand up and say my thing. 28 for coffees in 14 weeks, £600,000 raised. Not difficult, just persistence. 9 touch points, 6 month incubation with this chap, and we discussed the strategy in principle. We didn't go, right, you know, give me the money and give me the house. We were like, okay, so in principle, how might we work? And we discussed that over many cups of tea and lots of envelopes. What I love about being a property entrepreneur is you're usually in a cafe with a little scrappy piece of envelope and you're talking a multi-million pound deal. It's really good fun. You know, nobody knows, and that's what I love.
So you would say the private investor is as good as the mortgage host?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And better, he lent me 100%.
Okay.
How good is that? That is infinitely scalable, as long as you are very good at getting deals. You could, how many houses can you buy if somebody will lend you 100% of the purchase price?
Infinite.
Thank you. So that's why we've gone so fast.
Is that on a borrowing basis or shared
no.
basis?
No, I'm not married to him, so I'm... we're just friends, so I'm only going to borrow and not shared ownership. I will not share ownership with anybody because I'm not married. But I will do regular buy-to-sells with people. So I either borrow straightforward loans or do joint ventures buy-to-sells.
So what do you do with the guy, the businessman? You do.
He lends me direct cash.
Joint venture deals. Or
no, we've done joint ventures, but he prefers straight cash because
do
for
you
him.
Ask him what interest rate you agree with him.
Yes, he is more than everybody else. So he's over 10%.
Okay.
Which is too much,
he's
and you shouldn't be doing that.
No,
he's very happy with that. Everybody else, I'm now at 4 and 5%.
That's why I want you to take his money.
Of course it is. Of course it is. But how easy is it for me? I've got a deal machine that puts a deal in every single week, and I've got the money there waiting. Is so. And when you do the maths, if you were to look at the maths on bridging plus all the fees, it's actually very similar. And I totally trust this guy. We shake hands. Okay, we'll do the legals. We shake hands. He never steps back. I never step back. So it's job done. Okay, so that hopefully answers your question then.
Sorry, so when you say this private investor, so you just borrow the money?
Yes.
Yeah.
So the
but
ownership,
I never see the money.
The ownership of the house is only on your name?
Yeah, it's me.
Okay.
Yeah. And he's got a charge on the first charge on that one, a second charge on something else, and a personal guarantee. So I am pinned to the wall for it.
A second charge on what?
On another property. Because remember, this first property is knackered.
So that second property is yours?
Yes.
Well, so,
yes.
Okay, so he's got a security on that one and
yeah.
another one,
yeah.
so he's well covered.
He's covered. And a PG.
And you've shaken hands.
Job done. And I had a cup of tea.
And
the important stuff.
Instead of money, even it happens like, let's say you have money,
yes.
but you don't have documentation to get things, and the mortgage house provides you with this credit to get by your house. Other way around.
Okay. So I have the money. Yeah, you can do that as
you
well.
You have the money.
Yes.
He has the paper.
Yes.
Because bank won't lend you.
Okay.
You don't have credibility.
So you find a better financial advisor to get a bank that will lend you. So that's all about creating a team. Or you repair whatever credit or whatever difficulties
you wait for that time.
That. You wait for that time.
Okay.
Yeah, you could do it that way as well. But I would make sure that you've got some very clear legal documentation around that.
So that's what I'm... So how good or bad it is to get a person like that? And give his credit or his documentation, and you put them as a partner in that, and how risky it would be.
How many businesses fall apart because partners either fall out or rip each other off?
No, true.
I
ran a fair trade.
I've read that on the internet. So I just wanted to ask you your experience.
No, I ran a fair trade business in my 20s. I had 5 shops, fair trade, meaning we're trying to save third world countries, you know, in a kind of slightly naive young way. Guess what? My business partner ripped me off really badly.
Oh.
Fair trade business. So it hurt a lot, but it taught me something about human nature. So why, whoever the person is doesn't have the ability to buy houses right now, but you do have the ability to raise money, why don't you buy and sell together, 50-50 split, so that person who has the paper can own the property, because you don't need to own it, because you're going to sell it again. Both of you make, shed loads of money, and then you go buy keep, they go buy keep. Because you'll find it easier if you can buy for cash to refinance it when it's a clearly ready-made project already renovating and you know giving you yield, and banks will be quite interested in that. So I would do one-off projects, buy and sell, and then go your separate ways for keeping. You don't want to keep together unless you're married, and even then, you know, possibly not. So I've given you my pitch. I'm not going to give you it again. But why does he do it? Good rate of return, secure asset. But actually, interest. Because basically, he has all the fun of running a dynamic business with none of the hassle. Because he comes into the coffee shop, we buzz for an hour and a half, and then he goes home, and I go, oh man, I've got all this crap to deal with as well. You know? So, how good is that for him? And we've worked together for years now. And I have this with quite a number. I mean, some of the guys, in fact, some of the guys that Vanish introduced us to at that meeting, I work with. Totally decent guys. Really cool dudes. And for me, rinse and repeat, shared family values despite a very different cultural background in kind of every which way, you know, and an amazing brain across my business. And that actually, in the early days, was the number one benefit. You know, you kind of go in it for the money and come out of it for the brain, thinking that was what really made the difference for me. So, what's your fundraising objectives? Sorry, your key questions. Mine are really simple, and I will... And Ben and Barry, did you guys know them? Really nice guys, actually. Barry Davis, Ben Lepier. They used to run Bristol Pin, and they're really nice lads. And Simon Zutzi, obviously, is Pin. And he just went up to them and he went, "You muppets, she cleaned up in your room." And I did, because I was really hungry. I had a family, and I was really focused on making sure my family was safe. So I just raised all the money out of that room. And they were the hosts, doing all the hard work. Bless them. And it was all I did. I was hungrier. So my three questions were, what's your objective? So what's the first thing I asked you when you came in? I'm not raising money at the moment, so don't worry. But what was the first question I asked you, Chris, when you came in? What do you want to achieve?
Yes.
Yes. Now, I'm not raising money, so I didn't follow through. I started to look at how can I help you by giving you lots of information to look at what mindset you've got, and, you know, just give you that information about buying discounted. But first would be, what do you want to achieve? And it wouldn't be like, how many houses do you want to buy, but what are you looking to achieve? Is it, you know, how much cash are you looking to create, or how many assets do you want to have, or are you looking to put your kids into private school, or do you want to buy a camper van in the summer? You know, what is it you want to achieve, and dig into that. What's your time frame? And then how much is your pot? And actually, if you do the maths, that then tells me what they need to make as an APR, interest rate, to achieve their objective. Do you see what I mean? Like, I had the example that somebody wanted to buy a camper van, excuse me, and I think it was like 24 grand or something that they wanted to spend on this camper van. We were talking in November, they wanted it in June, and they had, say, like 100 grand or whatever. So I know they need kind of 24% return in about 8 or 9 months. Now, I actually know that my projects probably won't deliver that, so there's no point me stepping forward and working with them. By understanding what's your objective, a camper van, time frame, 8 or 9 months, and then what's your part, 100 grand, I know that I rule myself out of working with them, because my projects will deliver a 20% return in between 5 and 9 months, my buy-to-sell projects, and of course I want to take a slice of that as well as they do. So in that instance, I'm like, good luck, I won't be able to deliver that. But if they said half a camper van, then I'd be like, we are in, we can work, baby, because I can deliver you half a camper van with 100 grand, or if the person's money was 200 grand, I could deliver a whole camper van. Do you see? Because APR, or interest, or whatever you're going to call it, is a function of time and stock turn, isn't it? So if I understand what they want to achieve, and I kind of dig in and go, well, how much is it going to cost to send your kids to public school? And when do you need it by? And what have you got at the moment to make that happen? Then I can go, well, you need this much. Can I deliver that? Yes, brilliant, let's have a coffee. Can I deliver that? No. Okay, good luck.
Please. Of course you could have delivered it, couldn't you? Because how much do you need to buy a 24 grand camper?
Yeah.
10 grand?
Yeah, he wants to buy it.
So say 6 grand, you know, 25% down.
Oh my God.
That's 10 grand after high rate tax. They needed 10 grand in 9 months.
I'm so Scottish, like I don't do any renting at all, like at all. I don't do leasing.
All our vehicles are leased. I would never buy a depreciating asset. I only ever buy appreciating assets.
Interesting, no, I put money into a car because it's a toy. Oh, no. Otherwise it's 400 quid for a car. So isn't that interesting? So again, do you see why I used to hang out with you at Vanisher Sings? Because like I should have taken that guy's money and I was thinking 20, yeah. Like we're currently looking at microphones because we're doing a lot of filming and we had to rent one for 60 quid and I'm like, we're not renting again. I don't rent anything. Okay, but you're quite right. So having had a different mindset, you probably could have taken that guy's money and delivered the deposit for a camper van.
So it's actually really important to ask what they actually, how much they want.
And not to make assumptions that they needed 24 grand cash.
Which is interesting because they didn't want 24 grand, they wanted a camper van.
Yes!
Yeah.
And I've hung out with him for years and never done any business with him because I felt I couldn't deliver to his projects. Okay, screw up. There you go. Right, the other thing, so be smarter than me then. Be like, see Alex. The other thing to note is your investor S-bend. This is going to happen. At the beginning, and this is normal, this happens with mentoring clients as well, it's chill, don't worry, this will happen. At the beginning, your investor thinks you're amazing, oh my God, you can buy all these deals, oh my God, that's amazing, that's stunning, that's really good. Oh, you're doing it again, oh, you're kind of boring. And this happened with my big investor. He went off to some very exciting people, I sat there thinking, they're gonna rip you off. And, or rather, they didn't rip him off, sorry, there wasn't intent, their projects didn't deliver, and he's still trying to regain his £500,000 now. Yeah. And I tried really hard to say, don't do it, it's so blooming obvious. So what happened was, I became boring, so the opportunity to bring in all these properties became boring because we're very consistent. Now, ultimately, that's why someone's gonna work with you, because you're very consistent. But in the middle of the S-bend, that's really boring. Because remember we talked about providing buzz and excitement? Well, by the time you bring in a deal a week and it's 25% discount and you do it every single week, well, that's kind of like really boring now, isn't it? It's really, really boring. So then they kind of get bored of you and they think they can go elsewhere, and they probably will go elsewhere. So watch them. Just go, oh, they're doing their S-bend. They've gone elsewhere. And then they come back because unfortunately elsewhere showed some shiny pennies. Mm. And unfortunately elsewhere didn't necessarily repay. certainly not on time, and in this case, not. They come back because they like your consistency. So don't worry about it. When your investors go off, you just go, it's an S bend. They'll come back. And that's exactly what happens. Because and once they've gone off and been burnt elsewhere, they're going to be really, not grateful is the right word, they're going to value your consistency. And it's your ability to deliver consistently is actually what's going to make you wealthy, not the big fat one-off deals. Because that's when it's going to get, you know, a one-off deal is a 50% hit rate, isn't it? You hit it or you die. But if you go steady, 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 you're going to make them steadily wealthy. So be conscious of that and don't get upset when the S bend happens. First couple of times it happened, I was really upset because like, what? And then now I just know it's just normal. Okay, so now let's talk numbers. We were talking deal sourcing numbers and you say you've got 2 estate agents and you've got, you make a couple of calls a week and you've got 1 agent. Does that, to get that house, Monk Street, he did 126 phone calls in a week. He did 24 viewings in a week, he did 21 offers in a week, and he actually got 2 deals. And those are pretty consistent numbers. We do that pretty much. I mean, we don't always do 2 deals. Sometimes we do nothing, sometimes we do 3. It's like buses deals, you know, you do 3 weeks, nothing comes through. But we are currently, what's this number? I think we've got 7 weeks to go till our year end, and we're on 47 deals he's brought in. Right? No. 47 deals he's got over the line, so sorry. And it's like 60 odd deals he's actually brought in. So those are our numbers. And this is the important ratio I want you to be aware of, because again, when you're starting out, it's that wood for trees, efficiencies, oh my God, what's important? Well, if you do not view offer on 85% of properties you've viewed, I'll be kicking your ass, because now you're being inefficient. You're doing all the lovely nice to haves. Oh, it's lovely to be on site. Yeah, get back and do more research.
Please
do.
Why isn't 21 24 then?
Say again.
Why didn't you make 24 offers?
Just stuff like, I don't know, subsidence. We don't touch subsidence or crap.
Value in that, though.
Say again.
There's a value in that.
There is, but not for us. And we know when to say no. Okay. You're quite right. There is a value in that. But we run 3 sets of builders, and we are fast in, fast out, vanilla. So we just know where we stop at the moment. So just reasons like it ended up being a really crap house, like properly crap, or besides something that was really crap, or subsidence, or just stuff. Do you know something? Or maybe someone else. Yeah. So again, that might be your position, but for us, we're more vanilla. Because I want to be in within 6 to 8 weeks and back out again on the market or rented. Because again, early days, you cannot afford to be renovating something for 3 months. Oh my God, because you're going to run out of cash. Well, you're going to run out of cash anyway, but you should run out of cash long faster. So 85%, please, and I want you to measure your ratios of how many you're viewing to how many you're offering. Please.
Okay, so I've got absolutely no problem offering on properties, but the reason why I haven't is because I haven't got no money. So, like, if they say, yeah, okay, they get the deal tied up, then what do you do? Is it the investor first or the deal first?
So.
Or do they need to be
really great realized? Question. Mm-hmm. And in a perfect world, I will tell you to incubate investors first. But the reality is, you can't touch and feel investors. You can touch and feel deals. Mm-hmm. The reality is, you'll go for deals first, and then you'll have many sweaty nights until you find your investors. But I would tell you, how many business cards you collected here tonight?
Only yes.
Why not?
Well, I was waiting for the networking bit for that.
I thought you were waiting to get permission. Did you not hear Simon Zutzi say to Ben Barry that I cleaned up in their room? They owned the room. They paid for the franchise. I just cleaned up. Don't wait for permission. So the reality is, you'll get the deal first, and then you'll phone up everybody you know and sweat. That's how I did
right.
it. However, having phoned up everybody you know and sweated and not slept, everybody you know now knows you get good deals. They might say no to the first one,
mm-hmm.
and actually you need to be very chilled and very calm and not show desperation.
Swan-like.
Oh my God, yes. Yeah, I mean, it's no problem if you don't take this one.
Do you know anyone that wants it?
Do you know anyone that wants it? But do you know what? I know that you're interested generally, so why don't we have a coffee next week? I don't have time for this, I'll need you to take this one.
Yeah.
But obviously you can't say that.
Yeah.
And then because you're using that as a really great example,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to maybe look at you 3, remember the touch points,
mm-hmm.
6 to 9 touch points? So you, for every 6 investors, you're giving them a touch point, then the second touch point for the next deal, third touch point for the third deal. You're building up a position that you know how to source deals. And at some point, they're going to buy your deals.
Have you ever had a deal and not managed to find a...
In our first year, yes. And it was really painful, really embarrassing, and we worked really, really hard on investors ever since.
Okay, yeah,
yes.
That's what I'm worried about, sort of like breaking down a relationship with the agents.
Yeah, it's mortified.
Yeah.
And it will definitely happen in your first year. So what we did, I think some of you guys know, we ran every 2 weeks, Vanish Patel style, we ran investor days every 2 weeks after that. And people came to Bristol. Like, I never went to meet people. Somebody said, a guy did phone me up and say, I've got 30 million quid, come to meet me in London. No way, you come to Bristol, because that's prima donna behaviour. I'll show you my bank account. That's great, I'd love you to, John, come to Bristol. He didn't come to Bristol, I didn't spend his money. No big deal, next.
Right.
So you're looking for behaviours, which we'll talk about.
Okay.
Where on average you said they invest 50,000?
Yes.
How do you structure it if there's multiple people investing in the same deal? Because 50,000 wouldn't buy a unit.
So, not that you're going to, and not that I'm asking you to,
mm-hmm.
but say you decided to lend me money,
mm-hmm.
you're lending money to Susanna Cole, the person.
Okay.
In the most lovely way possible, what I decide to do with it is, I wouldn't say it's my choice, because it's not as blasé as that, but that's my choice. I am legally pinned. It's a legal document that I sign to say I've borrowed money from you.
Okay.
I wouldn't. So, but if you decided to joint venture with me, then you're lending money into a project, which is a property. And that's the difference. So I used to just put people together who lent me money, and I happened to have the funds to then go buy the properties. I would never put two investors in a joint venture, because
sure.
you've built the relationship with each other, so you trust each other. But now say I decided to put you together with Nick, you know, it's hilarious. I've done it, another sleepless night. I've put people together in a cafe because I trust you, and I trust you, and you trust me, and you trust me. 6 months relationships, you two never met. Shh. Cat with water pulled on, you know, it's amazing watching the body language. And you sit, I sat in this little fish and chip bar having a cup of tea around the corner from the project going, oh shit, that was a really bad idea. You know. So don't put investors together unless they really know each other.
So you give
suddenly
them
realise that you can't tell them both at the same time they're your best investor.
So you give them both security and their own independent deal with you as
yes.
opposed to a deal on paper.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. And without being too kind of naughty, the packs, who's downloaded our packs? Are you just one? Serious?
Sorry, I only got tickets for it. Michael only told me about it the other day.
Oh,
so, and then
yeah,
I only told Nick and
the
other day. Sorry.
It's
been like...
You've downloaded a fundraising pack. Useful? Yes. So I got all the legal documents I use. I must advise you, you must take legal advice because I'm not a lawyer. However, they cost me quite a few thousand quid, and I think it's like 25 or 30 quid or something. Yeah, and I've produced three so far, and the free one as well, for a while, and then I'm just about to produce the business strategy, I think coming up Wednesday, Thursday this week. So if you go on our website, for quite a while we got more excited at selling packs, because you can see on PayPal, you go in and you have to put your fingerprint on PayPal, and we got more excited about people's buying packs than selling houses. Because this is part of creative fun for me,
yeah.
you know, sharing knowledge and making it really beautiful and really making it really good. So you've still got deal sourcing, buy to sell, and then the free one, 101 lessons, and then the business strategy coming out this week.
Yeah, question. The investors you've gone to, have you ever?
They come to me.
They come to you.
I'm not being an RC.
No. Okay, so.
So I collect their business cards.
Mm-hmm.
I meet with them, but they come to me. Oh, and they should go to you too.
Yeah, if they could, that'd be brilliant. friends or family,
yes.
have they ever approached you?
Yes, in two different ways. So my best mate and my cousin
mm-hmm.
Was in my investor number one and my investor number two, and
okay.
they kind of had no choice.
Okay.
And my best mate and my cousin are still in. And after that, I went into a room, like this.
And that worked all right?
It worked fine. My cousin has a very nice watch. He has a couple of very nice suits, and he,
mm-hmm.
yes.
He's done all right.
He's paid for some of his leasing. Yeah, he's done great, and so is my best mate. The other benefit to that is, in the early days, my best mate's a guy called Mark. He helps me design some of my stuff. And I went, shit, help, running out of money. And he knows me inside out. I'm as honest as the day is long. So there may have been an occasion where both my best mate and my cousin, within 24 hours, put some money in to help me out, whereas I would never do that to a professional investor,
mm.
ever. So that was very, but they've done great out of me. I'm really pleased.
Was it good, a good experience learning from them before you sort of put yourself forward to the professional investor? Did you sort of do a practice dry run on how you present yourself to them? Or was
no,
it
This
okay.
is, so we're, I'm really close to my cousins. Bill, you've got money. Do you want to put it in? Right. Okay. Mark, you're my best mate. Put your cash in. So no, but what it was, the dry runs were good for. So one in two people will say yes to you, and one in two people will say no, as long as you screen them. What's your objective? What's your time frame? And what's your pot? Obviously, that statistic should have improved if I'd used Alex's brain and not my own. But one in two people will say yes.
That's your hit rate when you when
yep.
you've got them in front of you and you've done the screen and the filtering
yep.
and
yep.
you know they're of interest, you're of interest.
And the average that they'll give you is 50 grand. So to raise 100 grand, how many coffees do you need? Two coffees. One will say yes, one will say no, and the average is 50. It's been a long day. To raise 50 grand, how many do you need? Two.
Yeah.
To raise 100 grand, do you need?
Four.
To raise 200 grand, do you need?
Eight.
How difficult is that?
Sure, Costa loyalty account, like.
Mate, kitchen table.
Yeah.
I'm too busy to go to Costa. And always was, because of course, bear in mind, I don't mean I'm too busy in any fancy way. I don't mean fancy at all. I mean, you know, at that point, I had a full-time marketing director job, two kids, a fledgling property business that I had no idea what to do in yet and was, you know, learning. And I can't go to Costa. They come to me, my kitchen table. We used to run my mentoring group out of my house for a while. And all my early, yes, well, my mum was, honestly, we've got this amazing mentoring group, right? It was really professional, it's really, really high quality. But in the first years, my mum was frying up bacon rolls for them. Honestly, it was great fun. Because why spend money? And actually, why spend inefficient time? 20 minutes going to Costa? No, you come to me. Because if you're prepared for them to come to your house, is that going to help them trust you?
Mm.
You're not going to run away. They can see your kids. They can see what your kitchen looks like, because it's all in the kitchen. If they ask a question, you go straight to your filing cabinet and pull out all the information you can possibly give them. It's all very useful. It's all very good social cues for them. And it's very open, isn't it? You know, there's no dodgy hotel malarkey going on with, you know, smokes and mirrors. Right. So, deal analysis, I need you to be very good at this. We've spent quite a lot on private fundraising, which is I'm very happy to be guided that way, so we're not going to talk a lot about it. Suffice to say, one of the biggest mistakes I see people doing is actually getting to a deal. It won't be the first deal with the estate agent, it won't be the second deal with the estate agent, it'll be the third one, right? And because I used to give out electronic embarrassment, you know, ear pickups and little voice recorders to my mentoring clients, and Ash and I would be around the computer going, come on, come on, come on, come on. They'd get to a deal, and then guess what they do? Oh, can you send me that on email? Oh my God. You know, and we'd be like, I'd be like jumping on the floor. No! Because you say, you know, you get to a deal and you sit there going, it's a deal, come on! All you have to do is go, right, great, can we go see it in 2 hours' time? Because the minute you put down the phone, they're just like, loser, send you an email, yeah? Ash will have bought it, or the equivalent in your area of Ash will have bought it. So the biggest mistake people make is not being able to do the deal analysis adequately on the phone to be able to go out and book a viewing. You're not buying a house, you're booking a viewing. Obviously, I will need you to offer an 85% of viewings you book, so you need to be good at your deal analysis, but that's all you need to do, decide to take the next step. Professional offer, how did we get known? You know, I was this crazy 39-year-old with two kids. Ash was 22, you know, when I employed him. Have you seen the videos? He's Mr. Beard now. He's like no longer baby face, is he? And he's got more tats. He keeps coming out with more tats. But so how did we get taken seriously? On a Saturday night, when all my mates were going out partying, I was in writing emails with screen grabs and a letter with the screen grab of the deposit funds. Were the deposit funds mine? No, of course not. I didn't have any money because I kept spending it on property. I had a really good friend called John who had 180 grand, and I go, John, can I borrow your screen grab again, please? Thank you very much. I would never tell a lie, and hopefully I never do, certainly not on purpose anyway. I would say, I'm using investors' funds. John had never said he'd give me his 180 grand, he just regularly used to screen grab from me, kind of every 2 weeks. Thank you, John, that's very kind of you. I'm still in touch with him now, he's lovely. And I would send a letter through, and also an email. That's not gonna get me that house. It's gonna make no difference at all. So why did I do it? Because it helped me achieve standout. You know these estate agent meetings?
Mm.
How on earth do you slowly move from being this sort of crazy lady with an idea that she's gonna jump out of her job and a tattooed 22-year-old doing the sourcing to being kind of the number one buyer for that estate agent's office? by slowly, slowly, slowly coming up to front of mind and being visible.
Mm.
And by being visible, it's John's screen grab. They're probably going, oh my God, it's that guy again, it's John. And so by offering professionally, in those estate agent meetings, when frankly they're staring at each other going, well, what the hell do I bring to this meeting? Because my boss is here and I've got to talk about something. Ah, Susanna Cole. Oh yeah, yeah, she keeps sending the screen grabs. She's got some money. No, I haven't, John's. Maybe, should we try her on one? Yes, boom, you're in. So offer professionally, and remember your efficiency, offer an 85% of everything you view. So, we have covered deal sourcing, and we have covered to a degree raising finance, and I'm trying to do it from practical rather than theory and, you know, kind of plastic. I want you to see the kind of grit. I want to do some buy to sell, but I also want to be quite courteous to your time. If it was me, I would talk all night because I love property, but I am conscious that some of you may need to get home. And Sylvia Rye taught me this, because I would rather always give extra, and I would think that being a speaker, giving more time would be really useful. And she's like, do you know what? Some people have got kids to go home to, and they have to get to the babysitter. You have to be really respectful.
Okay, you're right.
So let's talk a little bit about buy to sell. But first, if anybody's seen our Facebook, you know that cake is enormously important to us as athletes. For my family, I've achieved my goal quite a long time ago, which is delicious. So now I'm kind of like geeky goals, like cost to capital as a ratio of rent roll. You know, and I'm like, oh, so I want it to be this, please, you know, all that stuff now. But my initial goal was safety and security of my family. And God forbid anything went wrong, you know, I can fund whatever we need, medically, you know, whatever happens, I am now the rock, which is amazing. It's really, really nice. But this is also what happens when you get a guy to order the cake for your mentoring programme, called Asha Basha, or a girl. So we celebrate a lot with cake. But I'm not getting
that. Is that because a slice has been taken already?
She's probably
waiting out the shop.
We seriously don't. Yes. So, Pembroke Road, which is a buy to sell. We do three intro workshops if you like. We do them for silly money. We do 49 quid plus VAT. Why? Because we want to get a look at you. Because we know that the people come on our workshops will come on mentoring, and frankly, we want to see what you guys are like. Because if I'm going to spend a year with you, I want it to be a really good year, so I want a really good quality mentoring group. So we do a buy to sell workshop, a raising private finance, and a deal sourcing. So, buy to sell, this one was in a recession. We do a lot of buy to sells. At any one time, we've probably got about 30 on the go. So there's a certain number sold, waiting for the money to come back in. There's a certain number under renovation, and a certain number agreed to buy but not yet bought. The kind of three triangles of the, so around about 30 at any one time. This was a recession one. We bought it pre-auction, so that we can talk about deal sourcing from auction. My favourite way of buying deals is auction. My favourite way of auction buying is pre-auction. So at the moment we are exchanging on a property, I think it's tomorrow, pre-auction, and then I might have walked past Ash and gone, no, I think you'd need to do some more deals, mate. So we're trying to buy 30 at auction at the end of this month. We won't get 30, but we've analysed 30 and we're attempting to purchase 30. We'll get between 4 and 7, but we are working on 30, knowing it'll drop down. So when people tell you auction deals are crazy, guys, we buy every single month from auction, pre and during and post, every single month. It's just that if you're only going to buy one, the likelihood is that one will go crazy. If you try, when I was buying just for me, I always tried to buy 4, knowing I could only buy one, and it didn't matter to me which one of the 4 I was going to buy. So always spread your bets, because then you're not kind of, well, I've only been to an auction once and not bought a property, and I was about as peed off as I was today with my 5 hours travel, because it's a highly inefficient waste of my time, isn't it? You know, nice cup of Earl Grey tea, but whoopee, I'd rather be hanging out with my mates. And that really bugged me, so I just increased the number that we were looking to buy in order to always bring one home. Pre-auction, and that was with a JV partner. So this one, the JV partner owned it. What do I need to own it for? I have the restriction on it, so they have the property, so the person that can get the mortgage can actually do it, and it's a 50-50 split. I did all the work, they did all the funding, split 50-50. And this one, for those that are kind of into magazines, This was in the recession, and therefore I dressed it beautiful. It was Eames chairs at £300 a chair. If you tipped upside down, you knew it was the originals. It was 1950s pebble tables, Urkel, for those that are not in the know. It was 1940s leather chairs bought at auction. It was tick, 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 tick on all the design magazines. What did I leave behind? White walls, beige carpet, and $12.99. It's white walls, beige carpet. But in a recession, I dress beautiful. In a high market, like at the moment we are, IKEA, all the way, all the way. So my team knows dressing inside out. We could tell you which shelf in Bristol you can get stuff on, right? And when we did an exhibition in London a year and a half ago, and we are professionals, right? We really know our stuff. I mean, we screw up all the time, of course we do, but we know our stuff. We hired a flat for all of us in Canary Wharf, right? And we really know our stuff. We all worked in and went, oh, it's lovely! Every single sodding thing in there was IKEA, and we were fooled for 10 minutes. You know, and then we went, okay, back in the box, it's IKEA. So in a rising market, IKEA, Argos, B&Q, Tesco. You know, don't mess around. You know, but in a recessionary market, you've got to dress it, and it's got to be beautiful, even if you're leaving three sets of £12.99 B&Q. So there, on buy to sell, you've got two different approaches. You all, in terms of design and presentation, you've also got two different approaches in terms of pricing, because return on capital employed is a function of time and money, isn't it? It's not just money. So in a recession, I got the highest per square foot that year for a two-bed flat. It took me ages, it took me 21 weeks to get an offer. Yeah, 21 weeks to get an offer. Why did that not bother me? Oh, sorry, 21 viewings, sorry, to get an offer. And it took me weeks. It took like, I don't know. I actually can't remember, sorry, but it took like maybe 10 or 12 weeks or something. It took a long time to get an offer. Because statistically, I knew that it was taking 17 viewings, all spaced out, to get an offer. So 21 is within an acceptable range. So if I know that it's gonna take ages to get an offer because people are not like fighting to buy houses, then I have to sell it really high, don't I? In order to get the same ultimate return on capital employed. So I have to dress the white walls beige carpet box with Eames, 1950s, 1940s, you know, to die for. I have to, because it suggests high quality when actually it's just white walls beige carpet. With 10 mil underlay, and 14 mil underlay if you can, so it's lovely and luxurious. But it's a bit of plastic, isn't it? So in a recession, I price high. I'm just like, you know what, mate, I'm smashing the market out. Because I know I have to wait anyway. In a high-rise market like this, I price £500 below the next person. But my properties are beautifully styled. If you've gone on any of our YouTube videos, or if you have a look at any of our Facebook, or go on our website, we've got loads of beautiful photos. And in fact, all these packs, every single photo is a property we've done. There's nothing, we don't import any stock photos at all. It's all our stuff. And I'm £500, why? Because my God, you know, 13 viewings, 10 offers, and it's not just about, can I get more money? Can I get the best buyer? So I want really fast stock turn in a high market like this, and I don't mind being slightly cheaper, because £500 says everyone goes to my property and not, sorry, your property. But when they get to my property and they're looking at each other, they realise they may have to go up. But it also, £500 says, if 10 of you, i.e. the entire section of this room, or just less than, then I can go, and what's your position? First time buyer, no deposit, no thanks. And what's your position? Cash buyer, ooh, like. You know, and so I can then figure out what your positions are, and I can choose the best quality buyer to make sure I beat the statistics of 1 in 3 falling out of bed. So weirdly, buy to sell is very counterintuitive, because you think in a rising market you go for the most money? No. 1 in 3 properties falls out of bed, make sure it's not yours. So I'm not going for first time buyer, I'm going for Mr. Cash. Thank you, Mr. Cash, or 50% mortgage, or, you know, no chain. And that's why I price slightly cheaper in a rising market than my competitors. In a recession, I'm like 10 grand, 15, 20 grand more expensive than an equivalent. But mine is the best looking one by a million miles.
Do you use an agent to sell to you?
Yes, we do. So in a recession, always use an agent because they're very skilled. A lot of my mentor, we are still Ash and I are having discussions, because he's a former estate agent. So we're having discussions, and he's winning at the moment, but I'll get my way. I mean, listen, this is my business. You know, he's part of my team, but I very much trust him, his judgment, so I'll listen a lot. So I think in a rising market, I mean, quite a lot of my mentoring clients, like Jethro East, he made, I think it was about 140 grand last year, didn't buy to sell, and he did it all himself. And he actually got his two buyers up by 40 grand throughout a week. It was really good fun because he kept texting me. So yeah, I think I'm watching with interest as to when we move to actually selling direct. So again, it's economics. So look at PESEL, political, economics, social, legal, technological, and environmental. Look at what's happening politically. You know, you've got a campaign at the moment. Economically, and make a decision based around the economics. In a recession, I need the estate agent to work their list like a crazy thing. In a rising market, frankly,
it's
yes. Let's be honest. Yes. Yeah. So, buying from auction. And how long do you want me to? When do you want me to finish? Because I will respect your time.
25 minutes, half past one.
Is that cool for you guys? You comfortable?
Yes.
Okay. Good. Please ask me more questions because I hope you'll get better value that way. Buying from auctions, pre, during, and post. Does anybody buy from auction at the moment? So two of us. Why not for everybody else? What's stopping you at this stage?
I think I get carried away. I think I would probably be like, yeah, no, I want it. And I'm like you say, you go and you sort of spread it over four properties. So you just think,
next.
It's a cut-off period. Yeah.
Yep.
Like, yeah. So I think that's probably why. Also, it's just a confidence thing.
It's so much fun.
Yeah, no, I would love it, but I haven't sort of, I'm a little bit like out of the game at the moment because I've had quite a lot of time off work. I'm just sort of like getting back out there. And I hadn't sort of thought of it as an option yet. That's the only reason for me personally. I don't know about other people.
For us, because we run a scaled business now, we actually look at auctions as a smoothing strategy to make, because, you know, properties are like buses. You know, 1 minute we could be buying, I'm over-exaggerating, but we could be buying 10, and then suddenly we get a dry spell and then we buy lots, right? Well, that's really great for me, who has to look at the money coming in each month. I mean, my break-even point is 40 grand a month for my team, you know, on my business. That's I've got to bring a fair amount of cash in before, and that's not my properties, that's an entirely separate business. So it's just to run the good property company, yeah.
My overheads.
So do you know what I mean? If we actually look at auctions as a smoothing strategy to make sure that we're buying every single month. And it's really interesting since we looked at that, oh my God, we just buy every single month. And we're not stupid. We always, like, Ash went to auction last month and there were two properties that he stepped back from because it was our top price and they went for 1 grand more. Am I bothered? No, because he did the right thing. But he bought other stuff.
And do you view the properties before you go to the auctions?
Yeah.
Yeah, because like sometimes you don't get a chance to view them, do you? Sometimes
no, you do.
They come,
absolutely.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's 15 minutes, so you've got to get in there and they do their 15 minutes. Because we know the auction houses, we might get to hear of them first.
Mm.
And so our complete strategy has been to be the number one buyer from both auction houses.
Yeah.
And he texted me about a month ago. And it's small things. You know, this property business is not made up of the big moments. It's made up of the little tiny moments. He texted me. He was dead excited. So we were number one buyer for one house. And then we wanted to be number one buyer for the next house. And he said he walked into, and they're quite posh, and Ash with his beard is not necessarily super posh. So he walked into that auction house, and the secretary said, I recognise that voice. And that sounds really silly, but that is it, we're in. We're absolutely in. If she can recognise Ash's voice before he even, you know, shows his beard, we're totally in now. You know, and that's really critical. You know, he's so excited about that. So not only do we view them all, we also get the lawyers to the legal packs. I would never buy a property at auction if I hadn't done the legal pack. So I raised £1 million 2 years ago in literally 2 hours, had a tea, cup of tea, 2 hours. So I raised £1 million in 4 hours to buy a property that was so beautiful. Georgian made up of 14 flats. They thought they were going to own it forever, so they didn't bother getting building regs because why would you do that? Well, why would you? You know, you thought you were going to own it forever. I mean, I would, but they didn't. So clearly it was non-mortgageable, so it had to be bought cash. So I raised £1 million. My top price was £960,000, and I did not follow my own advice, which was always have 4 properties that you're going to buy. Oh man, I was so blinded by the beauty of this property. It was all I could think about. I used to drive past it before the auction. You know, was so excited. And actually my core funder was the same guy, and then we put a bunch of people around about it. And Ash kept going, Sue, so some other flats. I'm like, nah, I'm not listening, they're crap. You know, they were not, they were very good, but they weren't beautiful, and I'd fallen in love. So I made the mistake of going to auction to only buy one property. And I had £1 million, literally kind of in my handbag, you know, with my leather gloves on. Me, please, thank you all. And I have to tell you, you know how you were nervous? The week before, so this was a Thursday, I think it was, and the week, or maybe a Wednesday, the week before, I lay there going, why am I doing this? Why don't I watch EastEnders like everybody else? Why am I putting myself into this kind of uncomfortable position? You know, that kind of neg talk, you're just being stupid here, Suze. What are you trying to do? Why are you doing this to yourself? Yeah, so don't worry if you get neg talk. We all get neg talk. Chill. It's not happy. It's not comfortable, but it was more fun going, me please, than listening to neg talk and turning on the telly. That's crap, you know. But I had an hour of going, you're an idiot. You're a complete idiot. What are you trying to achieve? What's this for? Why did you put yourself under the stress? Why do you need to do this? You know, all of that kind of neg talk. Because this was really out of my comfort zone. I'd never spent £1 million before, of not my money. Anyway, so unfortunately for me, it went for like £60,000 over my top price, and I will not go higher. And unfortunately for me, I stupidly didn't actually follow Ash's advice. So I had £1 million, and I know the market inside out in Bristol, and the set of 8 flats that he told me to have a look at, and I was like, I know best, idiot. I watched it, I could have made £180,000 profit, and I watched it go, and I would not buy it, because I knew I hadn't done the legal pack. I've never been so mad at myself in my life because I didn't listen to my own bloody advice.
You lost £180,000.
No, I didn't lose it. I lost the opportunity to make.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it was all day long, £180,000, clean profit. And my JV partner was going, let's buy it. And I'm going, nope, we haven't done the legal pack, no. So I'd always get the legal pack done. Now we're lucky, we do so many, we actually get the legal packs done for free. You probably won't at the early stages, but I tell you, it is worth the investment. Even though you sat there going, man, I've just paid for 4 legal packs and I haven't bought a property. You know, the safety, I lost the opportunity to make £180,000 because I was not going to buy something without a legal pack review.
What's involved in doing the legal pack?
Oh, it's all the kind of,
So you get it and then you give it to your solicitor?
Yes. So, briefly, buying at auction is a bundle of fun, innit? So, number one, the legal pack is supposed to be ready 3 weeks in advance. It will be ready the day before. Number two, you're supposed to be able to download it. There'll be a technical problem. Number three, your lawyer's firewall will definitely prevent you being able to send it on to them or them being able
so
to download it.
Right,
yes. So you, if you're working, you have to take a couple of days off. Number four, it's not going to be complete. Number five, their lawyer, the selling lawyer, is definitely not going to answer any of the questions your lawyer needs to be able to give you a report to tell you it's satisfactory. What else? Number six or number five, they're going to change the legal pack on you half an hour before the auction. So you need to have your lawyer's mobile phone number. Like, I was in here tonight and I was talking to my lawyer at 6:15 and then met up with John Mitchell. You need to be able to go, shit, they've just changed it and I've got absolutely no idea what this means. Can I read this out to you at like 6:30 at night before the auction starts at 7:00?
So you give it to your lawyers though, and they read through it and they say, this
yes.
is good, this is bad, don't go near it, or
yes.
these are the risks
exactly.
involved with it.
And you kind of chill out on most of the risks.
But you must know from seeing so much of them, do you
I
not
do.
Think you can fairly assess
no.
them on your own merit?
I wouldn't dare. I would rather not make £180,000 than make a mistake.
In fairness, I suppose if you get them free, then it's not an issue.
Yeah,
is
but
it?
Even then,
mm-hmm.
I could have read that. And I was just like, I just sat there and watched the hammer go down.
But you won't take that risk?
No. Oh, I felt sick though, sick as a dog. A one and two, if that's okay.
Do you do surveys pre-auction as well?
No. Because frankly, Alex will buy subsidence, but we don't. We go in and go, are the windows straight? Yeah, fine. Is the door frame straight? Yeah, fine. Bit of damp, doesn't matter. You know, everything else doesn't matter. I don't do subsidence. Is the extension falling off the back? Another drain's been crushed. No, buy it. You know. And then the only thing is, you need to, we do bridging, so things like auction finance, or I wouldn't do Shawbrook for our phone. Thank you very much. I'm so oblivious to IT, I didn't even notice. Somebody like auction finance is very good for being set up, or they're now called Together, aren't they? Just watch, they'll give you 6 months and then the interest rates go up, whereas we have a very good relationship with Shawbrook actually. In fact, our JV partners, if they even if they wouldn't get funding from Shawbrook because they're not experienced, as long as we're doing the joint venture, Shawbrook actually helped write the legal agreement, and basically our JV partners hand the keys to us, they'll get funding from Shawbrook.
And is that Shawbrook development financing or
Short-term funding, they call it.
Okay.
I'm doing a grade 2 listed house at the moment and I'm doing a chapel, I won't get 6 months worth of short-term funding because sod's law, that's, do you know, like if you're selling it, you won't have it sold in time. I'll always go for 18 months and it just means that you don't have any kind of disadvantage at month 6 because you're too tight, you know, for either refinancing or selling, just in case.
What sort of time scale do you need to initiate that with? Is that pre-auction or is that at a point of...
So, for you to buy it your first, like I wouldn't be worried about it now till I know I get funding all the time, but if it was my first one I'd do a decision in principle.
Okay.
And I have them kind of identify and subject to whether they like the house, and I've had that, I'm not asleep this night, but I would ask them to do a decision in principle for roughly how much you roughly want to spend. They still will be subject to the house, but that gives you a kind of a level of comfort going in.
You're a week or two ahead of the process, I guess.
Yes. However, just be conscious, I do not buy at auction with a mortgage. I've done it a few times. So I bought my second house ever. I bought for 85,000, worth 130. Oh, I thought I knew what I was doing, you know, at auction. And then my fifth house, I bought at auction, 93.5, which Ash now tells me, not that I'm making the case for assets and capital appreciation, is now worth 190. I did nothing, apart from 7 grand refurb again, but so just making the point repeatedly.
Yes,
about
I know.
Assets. So I bought that one, right? I'll tell you what, they were identical blooming houses with identical states inside. So I went to the same mortgage provider, Birmingham Midshires, and went, oh, easy, you'll fund that, won't you? And they came back, having bought at auction, you've got 28 days to exchange and complete, and went 100% retention. So do not use a mortgage company to buy at auction because you don't have much wiggle room time-wise. Use a company that's set up to buy at auction, like Auction Finance, who are now called Together.
Okay.
But obviously, I can't give you financial advice.
Sure.
Please do.
I was just going to say, obviously, I'm sure you give a reasonable, you're supposed to get a reasonable amount of business from me now, so I don't charge you for looking at legal packs. If I was going to go to auction, and I say to Mr. Solicitor, look at 4 legal packs, how much are we talking?
How much? Well, you're probably in the same position.
Well, yeah, I don't know anything like the volume you do at auction, but we pay 40.
40
so,
quid.
You really
so it's not 500 quid there. You know.
If you're going to buy a train ticket to go to the auction,
yeah.
That's what it's going to cost you to get
okay.
Yeah.
Right.
But try and give your lawyers as much help as possible because their firewalls, you know, blah, blah, blah. Yes. And just expect it to be a screw up.
To a pigeon's back.
Yes.
Sort of returns you look for. Like, what's your sort of
cut-off
point?
For the first couple of years we were doing 29% discount before refurb, and refurb could be hefty or it could be tiny. And then for some reason we went into our third year we were at 36% discount before refurb, and I think it was just we got better at what we're doing. So sort of that, so I don't want 10% and I definitely don't want at value because you'll run out of money. And then for a buy to sell I want a 20% markup after all your costs, including all the crud and corruption, all the gubbins, so all the legal, you know, the legal costs, the estate agent costs, you know, all the kind of interest rate costs, which on average, all of the crud, the crud and corruption, as my Uncle John would say, for a 100 grand house is going to be around 8 grand. So you might, you know, what's the man with the van and the cleaners and the window cleaners and the interest costs? Well, roughly 8 grand for a 100 grand house, you know, on top of buy cost, sell cost, you know, bought for, sold for, and renovated for. So I want a 20% markup on a buy to sell or walk away. I mean, 19%, I won't be kicking your ass, but 12% walk away. And I want you to do a 10% yield and above. And I didn't know what yield was. You probably do. Okay, good. Well done. You're further ahead than I was. I used to have it slipped in my purse.
Okay.
I'd walk into a property meet outside. You know how you're nervous coming into a room like this, thinking everybody else knows more than you? And I go, annual rent divided by purchase price. Right, that's yield. Okay, I've got it. Hello. Because I didn't know.
And then you never once get asked.
No. But at least I knew something.
Oh, I should have stood up then and said, should
have
then.
Yeah, you should
have.
Sorry.
I missed the cue.
Sorry.
Yes, you did. So I really want you to have 10% yield or don't touch it. Really, I want you to have 15% yield, but I want you to have 10%.
Sorry, and do you always recommend in your area? Have you got to know the
yes.
area really well?
Because there is no bullshit. Sorry about my language.
No, mine's terrible. sorry, everyone.
gold mine areas don't exist. It's just a load of crap. It really is. I feel really strongly about this. It's just statistical curve. And it's here. End of story. So that's height, and that's length. And that is volume of business. So we're in Bristol, and when I started, everybody told me you can't source in Bristol. Now, Bristol's kind of trendy, and quite a lot of the trainers are saying Bristol. Well, it's because we created that thought process.
Yeah.
So for the number of houses being sold, some are going to be sold high, loads are going to be sold average, and about 3% are going to be sold cheap. And that is, so if we lined up, all us little people would be on one end or the other end. So some tall people would be in the middle. I will either be very expensive or very cheap. And that is just a statistical average. And that will happen in every single location. So why would you go elsewhere? Just work hard in your own location. And then you have so many efficiencies around getting there, getting back, you know, being on site, putting your tenants in.
I was thinking about sort of like cheaper properties. A lot of people are buying in the Midlands and sort of the north of England now that I've come across personally. And I was thinking, because where I am, it's for something that's a single let, it's quite expensive. You wouldn't make any money on it.
Then do a multi-let or do a service department.
Yeah.
Or do buy to sell and buy it that 3% cheap.
Mm.
And then, so for example, this morning, working with Vicks, the only 2 hours I actually need to do a week, I've got 3 tenants that haven't paid yet. It is the 8th. On day 10, by the way, they get evicted. So they got 2 days left, Section 21 out.
Mm.
I'm like, Vicks, man, get on that. You want to be hand delivering letters today. So how can I do Vicks, man, get on that, drive up to Newcastle? You know, it's a 10-minute drive, hand deliver. And frankly, a hand deliver says, I'm in your face, mate, and you are going to pay me. She's very nice, Vicks.
She got tattoos.
Yeah, she does. She's 23 and she rocks.
Yeah,
she's absolutely smashing it. She's just been promoted to head of development. And that's the efficiency. And how much rent am I owed? I got a very high rent roll. I'm owed my entire life, apart from these 3 lads who are going to be paying us. I've got no worries they're going to pay us, they're just taking the money. £602.50 of unpaid rent my entire life. Because I am like, hello, hand delivered letter, nice to meet you, you'll pay us, yeah? Because you've been evicted in 2 days' time. And also my tenant segment. In a high quality area, my tenant segment is top end.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not worried these guys are going to pay. They'll be paying this afternoon or tomorrow. So pre-auction we've talked about, and it's all around the legal pack. At auction, it's not scary. Just go in, have your price. Please do.
Sorry, one more question.
No, it's more helpful.
Before we go to at auction, how would you approach a pre-auction offer? Because I've tried a few and just been buffered very aggressively.
Find out whether they'll sell. So the first thing to do is, as soon as the catalogue comes out, literally on the day, phone them up and say which ones are going to sell and which ones have to be sold in the room. So things like housing associations and councils have to be seen to be fair, they have to be sold in the room, whereas other ones, they'll sell pre-auction. So the buy-to-sell I told you about, that was a pre-auction. We bought loads pre-auction. And they'll say, you know, so this month, we've tried to buy loads pre-auction and we've only buying one. But we've put offers in loads and they've all gone, nah, not enough. Okay, fine, we'll go to room. We once tried to buy a property pre-auction and we offered whatever we offered, I forget the figure now, and they said, no, get lost. Okay, so we went to the room to buy it, and we ended up 14 grand cheaper than pre-auction.
Yeah.
Fine.
About the mentality of the seller at auction as well, you've got to remember, because if you don't sell before the day of the auction, it's a huge gamble that you're going to achieve anything at all.
Absolutely.
No one that sells at auction wants to be left with a property that hasn't sold at auction.
Absolutely.
So the certainty is at pre-auction.
Yes.
So that's the benefit to the vendor then, basically. Okay.
You're spot on. And I had a really good example with that. I bought a really nice little, well actually it was an okay little house. Bought for 103. I did a 20 grand refurb or 18 grand refurb or something like that. And I sold it for 155. And that was pre-auction. And actually I got to meet the lady, she was really lovely. What it was her mum had Alzheimer's. And she wanted absolute certainty and security for her mum's fees. And so the most important thing for her was the security to know what mum's fees were, which is exactly what you're talking about. And you know, we had a really nice time chatting. So at auction, great. Go in, figure out your top price, make sure you've had your legal pack done. And then depending on where the auction house is, so they'll go like, you know, 70 grand, 75 grand, 75 grand, 80 grand. Oh, they hate me. So they go 80 grand, 81! Yeah. And they're like, oh, bugger off, Suze. Because now they have to do 82. And I go, 82, 500! Loving it, loving it. I know you really don't like me right now, but sorry. And now, within two bids, instead of going up 5 grand, 10 grand, 10 grand, 15 grand, 15 grand, 20 grand, yeah, it's 500, 1,000, 1,500. So I've slowed the bidding down. Now, not every auction house will let you do that, but mine do. So bad luck. Positioning, oh, who cares? Who cares? Price point, who cares? So two things. I don't care where I sit, because it really doesn't matter to me. I am not fighting against anyone. I'm either buying that house or I'm not. I got no body language about it. When you go to an auction, it's really interesting. There's a bunch of Asian families who stick together and don't do the body language thing. Then there's a bunch of white builder men who do the body language thing, which says, get off, it's mine. And you're like supposed to, yeah, you're supposed to feel really nervous. Yeah. And then there's like one lady, me, cup of Earl Grey tea, me please. And so for example, Ash does no body language at all. In fact, about 75% of auction bids we put through the auction house because we don't want anyone to know it's us. That's how important non-body language is to us. We don't. Ash doesn't look like a guy who buys houses. He's sat there with his, you know, hat backwards, and like I'm like, are those trendy? What trends are those? I'm like, is that cool? Could you teach me? I don't know. So, and we don't want anyone in that room to realise how big a purse he's got. Not at all. So he only buys about 25% directly. The rest we give the bids to the auction house, and he sits in the room, and we allow the house to bid on our behalf. So who? What do you need to show off for? Do you know what I mean? All you're doing is creating a competitor. And there's no need for that at all. And then, so positioning is important. And then what the price point is? I don't care. The one thing that people say to me is, well, how much did you get off the asking price? I don't care. The asking price has got no correlation to me in any of my equations at all. I absolutely don't care. What I care is, how much did I buy it for? How much is it worth? And what's the difference? That's what I care about. So I got no interest at all what the price point is. I completely ignore it. It's got no relevance at all. I'll buy something at full asking price if it's 25% discount and we spotted a bargain, or I'll buy something very discounted if we can. So it doesn't matter. Get it out of your head. That's a retail buying mentality. Right, I think we are a couple of minutes away, so let's crack on. And post-auction, you just clean up. Two things post-auction. Either the person is in the room, and they often are in the room to see their stuff sell, and as you say, they've got nowhere to go if it hasn't sold. I mean, who's going to buy something that didn't sell at auction? You've got nowhere to go. So you might identify who your sellers are in the room, and just maybe put them aside them. Because, you know, as a woman, nobody thinks women buy houses. It's really helpful to me. I've got no presence at all. Well, it's a sexist industry, so I just use it to my advantage. Because I got no presence in a field full of men who assume that all the men are the buyers. So if you're a man, tone down the alpha male behaviour so that they think you've got no presence, because it doesn't matter what they think. So I'll maybe just sit beside the person I think selling the house just to hear them. Or find out who the lawyer is at the front panel selling that property and try and buy it that night. If you don't buy it that night, by post, writing a cheque, buy it at 9 o'clock the next morning. Okay, so get in fast again. We buy quite a bit post-auction. One more, I think, just for the structures and how we do joint ventures. So you can structure a joint venture, frankly, any way you want. I'm not saying this is the right way, it's just the way that we do it. The one thing we do is we make sure every joint venture is structured exactly the same so that none of our partners feel that someone else is getting a better or worse deal. And we will walk away from doing business with somebody if they decide to try and fiddle around with the agreement. At the beginning, you will definitely feel that the person with the money has the power, and I don't mean this rudely, but they don't. There are more people with money than people with deals. That's just absolutely the case. And at the beginning, you will definitely think that they need to run the show, but they can't find the money-making opportunity. And once you get into this industry more, you'll realise there are tons of people with money. I raised £1 million in 4 hours from having met a whole bunch of people and done a bunch of stuff and been a bit public about it in order that people trusted us. So if you can raise £1 million in 4 hours, which, and it's nothing to do with me, nothing at all, it's just the statistical facts of this industry, there are clearly a lot of people with money out there that are willing to work with people that can do deals. So be stick to your guns and don't change. The way we do it, they own it, because why do I need to own it? So they buy it, so they feel quite secure, and that generates more trust, because what do I need to own it for? We put a restriction on it. We will not start the refurb until every penny of the refurb money is across. Why? Because, you can imagine, we've had a couple of incidents where we're just like, you know, because I will not shelf my builders at all, so I will have to make sure that the money is in the cross. And then when it's renovated and sold, we will only lift the restriction once the lawyer, we don't get paid directly from the JV partner, because potentially you might be chasing a little bit for the money, and I've got no interest in running a debt management department. We want the lawyer, the JV, we invoice the JV partner, and the lawyer doing the selling of the house pays us. So it's the same way that estate agents get paid. So you're not chasing anything, you're not putting resources in, they own it, they feel comfortable, it's a 50-50 split. Now you can do any split you want, but that's how we do it. And they actually pay the funding, because I'm paying the 40 grand to run the business every single month, and they're not paying for that. I'm just going to leave you with 13.3. Be aware. Is everybody aware of it, at least? Okay, it's important when you do joint ventures. So you can borrow money directly, and that's a clear written legal agreement with a clear outcome for the partner. So they know what that they're getting. It's a straightforward interest rate. So there's no mystery to that. But a joint venture is completely variable, isn't it? I may say I think it will sell within this region, but I can't guarantee it, because it's a variable opportunity, because the market ultimately is going to decide. And quite rightly, since the 1st of January 2014, the government has said, look, that's risky. And frankly, the people getting into that game need to have some knowledge about financial risk about them. So 13.3 is simply a piece of legislation that means that you have to do an assessment on your business partner before you even offer them a buy to sell to do jointly. In our fundraising pack, we talk through our processes for you. Final questions. I do have more, but I do think it's appropriate for the folks that need to go home, that we maybe finish there and then we can have a chat in the bar or the cup of tea. But any final questions for you guys? So I've covered raising finance, and I've covered joint ventures briefly. I've covered deal sourcing and from estate agents and from auctions, pre, during and post. And I've covered buy to sell both in a recession and in a rising market. And I was hoping to give you as much, really what I would have wanted when I was starting out, give me content, you know, I'm here, I could be at home watching telly. So I hope that's given you a good amount of content. I have done a tiny plug for our packs, because we get very excited when people buy them, and frankly, I put an awful lot into them, so they are very good. So I hope that you do go online and get them. They're like 25, 30, 35 quid or something like that.
So just on the website?
Yes, under the resource section. We're now going to be releasing some, yes, I get really excited because they're just my next creative thing. It's really good fun. So any final questions from you guys before we close tonight? Please do.
Hiya.
Hello.
You mentioned
it's your first evening here as well, isn't
it? It is, yes. Yes. Thank you very much. It's been a really, really interesting talk. Thank
good.
You. You mentioned that when you raise finance, you offer a 4-5% return.
I do now.
You do now, yes. Okay, and obviously. So how do you sell that? What's your specifics? Because you know, my money is in a bank, etc.
Okay. So when I started, I offered 12%. You know, watch me bleed. And I raised £600,000 and I paid 12%, which is 72 grand. Yes. Yes. But I was a completely unknown, a big risk. And that's another reason why, you know, you don't become a millionaire overnight, because you're paying everybody else the cash. And of course, at the same time, you're paying for a refurb and you're running out of money. So you have to plan your cash flow for about 18 months. You probably won't sleep for that time anyway, so you might as well just stay up and do your cash flow. So I did start, like everybody else, offering far too expensive loans. But it got me started. And then the following year, they went down to 10%, because I told them that, 6 months in advance, and then down to 8%, then 6%. So a couple of stats and then I will answer your question. You know the maths, 1 in 2 say yes, 1 in 2 say no. On average, the person is 50 grand, so 2 coffees for 50 grand, 4 coffees for 100 grand. That is not my maths, that is everybody's maths that I've spoken to. Secondly, that only 20% of what you raise in the first year will come away. So all the hard work is in the first year, and say you raise like a million, which you might want to start a little bit lower, but say you raise a million, only 200 grand will actually, on average, be called back after the first year. So if you want to keep topping up at a million, you only need to raise 200 grand in the second year, plus you've got a track record. So all the it's like a rocket, all the fuel is at the beginning. And then thirdly, I started offering, and it's crazy money, you know, oh my God, you know. Whereas now, would you like to lend me 10, 20 or 30,000 please? I'll pay you 4% and I'll give you 28 days notice. Whereas previously, and I've got the loan agreements in the fundraising pack, previously it would be a year's agreement. And I would previously start talking to them about the following year, 6 months before their money was due to come back out to them, because I needed to plan my cash flow. So it'd be like, okay, you've lent me, I don't know, 60 grand, great. In 6 months' time, I'm due to pay it back. What are your thoughts? I'm moving it down from 12% to 10% or 10% to 8%. Where would you like to be? Please, Susanna, please keep me. Okay? So you make sure that you're not having to give these, excuse me, large lump sums back. Or if you do, you've got 6 months' notice so you can do something about it, because property's like a big tanker. You know, it's very slow, you know. However, now I switched, and this was a pure vanishism. This was not my idea. He's far too smart. So now, would you like to lend me 10, 20 or 30 and I'll pay you 4%? I give you 28 days notice. I know that you are here to buy a property, so you've clearly got a lump sum. So you need your money ready, but obviously even when you agree to buy a property, to actually buying it, it takes, you know, a month to 2 months. So you might as well get interest on your money. I'll give you 28 days. And you're like, Suze, can I give you 50 grand? No. I only want 10, 20 or 30, because 10, 20 or 30 is not going to make me sweat at all, because I can pop that out with cash flow. And if for any reason all of my cash is tied in, I'll hand the baton over to you. And that's not going to make me sweat to raise 10, 20 or 30 off you. It might make me sweat to give you back 70 to 140 with a 28 days notice, so I don't want it, thank you very much. I want 10, 20 or 30. So would half this room like to give me 10, 20 or 30,000 with a 28-day notice period at 4%, because mate, you've all got money in the bank because you're all about to buy property. So why don't you have a little bit of interest? I'll pay you on a monthly basis, and then you can call on your money within 28 days. And you raise a lot of money that way, and it doesn't make you sweat, and the interest rate doesn't make you sweat. Because even some of the very big names are still paying 12%, and I have conversations going, you're mad! So switch it around. But that's once you've got a large base of people that trust you. Switch it as fast as you can.
One of the repayment terms of the investors is the interest all rolled up at the end.
Another vanishism. I started off, like any little duckling, thinking I'll roll the interest up at the end. And he kept saying to me, I want it to hurt, I want you to pay monthly. And I was like, no, I don't want to do that. He's absolutely right, as usual. And the reason for that is twofold. I always pay monthly now. If someone says I want the interest at the end, no, sorry, I'll pay you monthly. No, because number one, unless your systems of monitoring stuff is really organised, and I am quite a geek, so I'm quite organised, but nonetheless, you still sit there and go, am I sure that entry in that spreadsheet is correct? Because I would hate to, rip somebody. I would hate to be incorrect. I think that's the best way of putting it. Number two, they have no indication of whether you're going to pay them back or not. Whereas I had a guy, James, really nice guy, he lent me 80 grand, that's right, 80 grand, and I paid him every month. And after the year, he got his money back, actually, used the 20% attrition, and he said, thank you so much, Susanna, no one has ever paid me on time, you're so reliable, my father-in-law wants to lend you money. And I wrote back going, James, it was a standing order. So my investors see my reliability. And number three, it hurts me. And therefore, it's real and not BS. Do you know what I mean? You're not pretending this debt isn't payable at some point. So always pay monthly, mainly because your investor starts to trust you.
So do you start paying them back out of their own money initially?
Initially,
yeah. Just so like 250 a month, get it out.
Standing order. And obviously, folks, have the private investor money come into a certain bank account and go out of the second bank account. And I've done a very good video on bank accounts.
Is that on YouTube?
Yes. It's the most watched video, is Vanish's advice. The best advice I ever got given is with the title. Yes, if you just look at my videos and look for the most popular, it's that one. Because I think it is really good, it's really unsexy, but it's really good advice. Obviously have your private investor money quite separate from the evidence that you're showing to show that you can afford the property or your rent income. Have them very separated as bank accounts, just for cleanliness. Are we done?
Yeah. Any more for any more?
Any more for any more? You've been quiet. Anything for yourself? No. So you're going to get more than 10% discount now?
I think so.
Good. I'm glad. Please do.
Question. Have you an instance whereby you've, when the investors have recalled a large amount of charges putting with you, and do you always prepare for that? Or rather, in your early days, did you always prep for that?
Yes. So the question is, have I did where somebody's recalled a large amount of money? Yes. So in the early days, large amounts of money was a year long, and I would have a conversation 6 months in advance. But I've had twice where technically I didn't need to give them the money back yet, but one, their mum died. And although I could sit there and play officialdom and say, well, actually, mate, you're slightly screwing me here because like this is going to kill my cash flow. Come on. So I scrabbled around to give them their money back because it's not fair not to. But it wasn't very much fun for my cash flow for a little period of time. Yeah.
Just on the structure where you've got 28 days notice.
Yes.
So you don't sign them up to like an annual term?
No.
You just keep it rolling and...
Yes.
Okay.
So how many people call me back in 28 days?
Zero.
Thank you. Mm. How many people are in after a full year?
Everyone.
95%.
80%. Okay, so it's 28 days at the start.
At any point.
At any point, okay.
Any point. So you lend me 20 grand, and at any point you can give me 28 days notice.
Okay.
And to be fair, I mean, listen, I tried playing really fair. If you turn around and went, I'm desperate for it, I'll give it back to you early. You know, with my builders, like we run three sets of builders at any one time. They're not our builders. They're their own firms, but they work almost exclusively for us. And I've worked with people like 3 years, and every now and again I just check in with them, and I phoned them up last week and went, right, we paid you like 30 grand and 30 grand. How are you doing cash flow? Because he's on a really big build for me at the moment. How is your cash flow? At the moment I've got some money, because there are moments when I don't have any. If you need it, I can pay you early because I know I've got you to pay you another 30 grand in 6 weeks' time. And he texted me within a day going, would it be all right if you could pay me half early? Yeah, no problem. Like, try and work with people, you know. And one time I've had to turn around to him and go, is there any chance I could pay you late? And so if you, I try and help as much as I possibly can.
Sure.
Yeah. Any more for any more? Are we done? So, your target, collect business cards, raise private finance, source discounted deals, and do a bunch of buy-sells. Won't take long. Okay?
Thanks, thank you.